morning, we continue with our study of the prophetic book of Daniel. So if you'll turn in your Bibles to Daniel chapter 7, we're going to read beginning at verse 15. We're going to read the rest of the chapter beginning at verse 15 and take this as a chunk. Daniel chapter 7, beginning at verse 15. I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit within my body, and the visions of my head troubled me. I came near to one of those who stood by and asked him the truth of all of this. So he told me and made known to me the interpretation of these things. Those great beasts which are four kings which arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Then I wished to know the truth about the fourth beast, which was different from all the others, exceedingly dreadful, with its teeth of iron and its nails of bronze, which devoured broken pieces and trampled the residue with its feet, and the ten horns that were on its head, and the other horn which came up, before which three fell, namely that horn which had eyes and a mouth which spoke pompous words, and whose appearance was greater than his fellows. I was watching, and the same horn was making war against the saints and prevailing against them until the Ancient of Days, and a judgment was made in favor of the saints of the Most High, and the time came for the saints to possess the kingdom. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be a fourth kingdom on earth, which shall be different from all other kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it in pieces. The ten horns are ten kings who shall rise from this kingdom, and another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the first ones and shall subdue three kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and laws. Then the saints shall be given into his hands for a time and times and a half a time. But the court shall be seated, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and destroy it forever. Then the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. This is the end of the account. As for me, Daniel, my thoughts greatly troubled me, and my countenance changed, but I kept the matter in my heart. Lord, here we are confronted once again with the prophecy of Daniel. You revealed to him certain truths, and with that, we are able to benefit from what he received and wrote in the scrolls for our betterment and for our preparation. I pray that you'll help us now to hear, to learn, to receive, and to do whatever is necessary to prepare for what's coming. In your precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Well, as we know, Daniel received a detailed vision. And along with that vision, he was given a detailed interpretation. And you know, you hear that and it sounds pretty cool, at least on the surface. But Daniel was given the privilege of receiving an incredible amount of insight, prophetic insight. Apparently, this insight didn't set very well with him. In verse 15, he said, I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit within my body, and the visions of my head troubled me. Again, at the end of the chapter, the last verse that we read in verse 28, this is the end of the account, he said, and as for me, Daniel, my thoughts greatly troubled me, and my countenance changed, but I kept the matter in my heart. You see, there's the problem with prophecy. The problem with prophecy is that too much information can be a bit overwhelming. Prophecy can produce a certain amount of distress. And where it hasn't caused some distress, perhaps it should have. Nebuchadnezzar experienced a bit of distress when he had his dream. You remember in chapter 2. And in the very first verse of that chapter, it says, "Now in the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's dream," Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, I'm sorry, Nebuchadnezzar's reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, "and his spirit was so troubled that his sleep left him." So Nebuchadnezzar saw a vision of a dream of troubling times that were ahead that troubled him, obviously, so much that he couldn't sleep. Once again in chapter 4, he dreamed again and with similar results. In verse 4, "I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at rest in my house, flourishing in my palace. I saw a dream which made me afraid, and the thoughts on my bed and the visions of my head troubled me." So there's this distress, this trouble that was bothering him. It troubled him when he heard the details. In fact, Daniel was troubled when he heard the details of Nebuchadnezzar's dream. In chapter 4, once again, in verse 19, it says, "Daniel was astonished for a time, and his thoughts troubled him." But unfortunately for Nebuchadnezzar, he didn't heed the dream's warning, and his kingdom was taken away from him for a time. In chapter 5, we have a new king, King Belshazzar. And Belshazzar also had a dream or a vision, and King Belshazzar's vision should have frightened him. But apparently it did not. Since he failed to heed the warning, his life and his kingdom came to an end that very night. Now, throughout the book of Daniel, we will see how that divine revelation produced a certain amount of fear and or perhaps even concern. In fact, other prophets in similar situations throughout the scripture had very similar reactions to the revelations and the prophecies that they had received. Why does this prophecy cause Daniel so much distress? What was it that upset him about the future? And in fact, we might ask, should we be troubled as well? Now, prophecies are given to us so that we can look at current and even future events from God's perspective and then make corrective changes. That we would choose then to perhaps change our ways or live in a way that is fitting the prophecy or the revelation. Prophecy provides us with an opportunity to think and to act in a way that will please the Lord, as He is the one who governs all future events, the one who brings them to pass. Since He's already in the future, if you will, He's able to reveal to us what things are ahead and what we can avoid. Now, in a general sense, chapter 7 of Daniel reveals to the prophet how the future of the world is going to play out, and he does so with stunning detail. So much so that Daniel was troubled. Why? What troubled Daniel by what he was seeing? Well, I think part of it is that he didn't fully understand what it was that he was seeing. This first 14 verses of Daniel 7 describe the vision of those four horrifying beasts and their vicious personality and natures. Each beast, of course, as we remember, were more destructive than the one that was visioned before it. And of course, that disturbed Daniel. But that fourth beast really got under Daniel's skin. And that's why he kept returning to it and kept asking about it. In verse 16, he said, "I came near to one of those who stood by and asked him the truth of all of this." And the angel was, of course, pretty happy to answer Daniel's questions. He didn't offer any resistance, but he was able to provide him with further details to the vision. Verses 17 and 18, we already read it. But Daniel wanted more. He wanted more information. He was still stumped by the vision of that fourth beast. And so in verse 19, Daniel said, well, I wish to know the truth about the fourth beast. And so he asked again for more details. And once again, the angel was glad to give those details to him. Important lesson that we have here. It's an important lesson for when we get stumped or when we may have spiritual questions of our own. The key that Daniel is showing us here, the lesson that he's showing us here, is that we need to keep asking. If you don't have the answer that you're looking for, keep asking. Keep seeking for answers. In fact, I believe that the Christian church would be far better off as a whole. We would be a heck of a lot stronger if we were more curious about spiritual things. We're so curious when it comes to Hollywood gossip. Inquiring minds want to know. We want to know all about the junk. Have you ever felt yourself drawn into the gossip of Hollywood? I get that way, you know. You troll the Facebook or you troll the internet or you turn the channels on the TV and you hear they want to start talking about, oh, what happened to Brangelina? And you think, oh, what do I care about that? Why do I care? Why am I being drawn into that? And you stop yourself, hopefully you will, you stop yourself and say, no, I don't care about that stuff. And you push it away. It's just silliness. I got enough problems in my own life. Why do I need to worry about what's going on with Brad and Angela? I don't care. We want to know the scoop on our favorite stars. We're curious enough to want to know what goes on with our favorite sports teams. You bet we are. Some of us are so good at it, we know the team's stats. We know their schedules forward and backwards. We actually know their records from 10 years ago. We have it recorded right here. We know how healthy the players are, how they're going to stack up against their opponents. We've got it all. And you know what? I got to be honest with you. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. So long as we'll cultivate a deeper curiosity for spiritual things. But sometimes spiritual things are left on the bottom shelf, so to speak. I so often hear of Christians who say, well, I don't really know all that much about the Bible, or I don't know all that much about prophecy. But the problem is that they think it's okay to stay that way, to leave it like that. Well, yeah, so I don't know that much about the Bible. What you're saying is it doesn't interest me. That's really what you're saying. I have no interest in it. Because if it was a sports team or the Hollywood gossip, you'd be interested. Or whatever. You can fill in the blank. It doesn't have to be one of those two things. There are plenty of things that seem to draw our interest, but to conjure up or to build an interest about spiritual things is really a denial of the flesh. We have to die to the flesh that wants other things because my spirit is starving. I'm supposed to pursue spiritual things. So we are able to study our Bibles, to learn, and to gain more spiritual knowledge, Bible knowledge that leads to spiritual things. And that starts with a love and a passion for God. If you love God, if you're passionate about God, you're going to want to know Him. How do you know God? Certainly not by things you feel. It's not by the things you feel. Otherwise, you'd be finding God at the stadium watching the football game. It's not about feeling. It's absolutely about what you know. And what we know about God can only be found mostly, primarily, in the Scripture. So you can't have a proper relationship to God without a proper relationship to the Scriptures. And so if you're interested in God, if you're interested in spiritual things, then you should read the Bible and look for more revelation. It's good to do that. It's good to pray. It's good to ask God to reveal greater truth to you from the things that you're reading in Scripture. That is what I would call a healthy Christian discipline. This is especially true in the area of Bible prophecy. It's not as easy as just reading and comprehending. I wish it were that easy, but even the great prophet Daniel will tell you that it's not that easy. Because here we find that he didn't completely understand what he was being told from the Lord himself. And so he had to inquire further and seek again and ask these specific questions. Now, there are going to be plenty of times when we need to do homework as Christians, to apply some good old-fashioned research to the things that we're stumped on. And God will honor our efforts and reward those pursuits of ours, which is always a good thing. Remember what Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you. I think another cause for Daniel's concern and troubled spirit must have been this issue regarding the saints. You notice how often the word saints are mentioned there, the saints of the Most High. I mean, these saints started off fine, well enough, but then, well, it doesn't end very well for them, at least not at first, for this group of people known as the saints of the Most High. Now, the angel, by the way, many believe this angel, this individual here, which we believe is an angel, was none other than the angel Gabriel. He shows up later on in the book of Daniel, so that's why it's assumed that this may have been the angel Gabriel who was conversing with Daniel in this chapter. But the angel told Daniel that these great beasts are four kings and representing four kingdoms which are going to arise or rise into power out of the earth. He then reassured Daniel in verse 18 with the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. That, of course, is the good news, wonderful news. In other words, what he's saying is that history is going to play out, it's going to run its course. In the end, the last of these four kingdoms is going to produce a most wicked type of king, one that we know to be or will be the Antichrist. But after it's all said and done, it tells us that the saints of the Most High will take control and rule the earth. Now that's not so bad when you put it in that light or in that way, but the useful angel that is he's providing this information hadn't quite finished giving out all of the details to the vision. Daniel's still captivated by that one little horn, the Antichrist, kept pressing and searching in order to understand more about this Antichrist person. And so we read there in verse 19, I wished to know the truth about the fourth beast, different from all others, exceedingly dreadful with its teeth of iron, its nails of bronze, which devoured broken pieces and trampled the residue with its feet, and the ten horns that were on its head, the fourth beast's head, and the other horn which came up, from which three fell, namely, that horn which had eyes and a mouth which spoke pompous words, whose appearance was greater than his fellows. It's the Antichrist. Now, Daniel, who seemed to have watched this vision in Technicolor, much in the same way that you and I may watch a TV show or a movie or a video. He says in verse 21, I was watching, and that same horn, the Antichrist, was making war against the saints and prevailing against them, winning, defeating them, until the Ancient of Days came and a judgment was made in favor of the saints of the Most High, and the time came for the saints to possess the kingdom. So what the prophecy is showing is that the saints are going to be victorious, but not until they experience a great deal of trouble. And so Daniel inquired about it, asking about it. Inquiring minds want to know, and so he kept asking. The angel told him that this fourth beast was going to be an extremely violent one who, in verse 23, shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it to pieces. But then the angel revealed the most distressing part of the news. In verse 25, he said, "And he shall speak pompous words against the Most High, and shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law. Then the saints shall be given into his hand," into the hands of the Antichrist, "for a time and times and half a time." We understand that to be 3.5 years. We'll talk about it as we go further into the book of Daniel, this period of the great tribulation, and the worst of it being the last 3.5 years. Well, this fits with other parts of Scripture which detail what will actually happen to the saints of the last days during the period known as the Great Tribulation. John the Apostle, speaking about the Antichrist and about that Great Tribulation, he said in Revelation 13, "Then he opened his mouth," the Antichrist did, "in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven." In verse 7 of Revelation 13, "It was granted to him," to the Antichrist, "to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation." And God is going to permit that. That too is troubling, wouldn't you say? Now, if Daniel is sitting there and he's watching this, he's going, whoa, wait a minute, what? They're going to win, but then they're going to not win. Well, they're going to get defeated. They're going to be overcome. I'm troubled by all of this. What does it all mean? Well, these verses, of course, and all that I've read to you from the New Testament as well, are telling us that prior to the coming of the kingdom of God, when he is reigning victoriously upon the earth, the saints are going to suffer at the hand of the Antichrist, even to the point where they'll be overpowered by him. You know, I find it interesting that often when the Bible speaks about God's deliverance, it's also linked with suffering. Before the Israelites were delivered out of Egypt and brought into the land of Canaan, they suffered at the hands of the Egyptians. Even the Apostle Paul said, we must through many tribulations enter the kingdom of God. He also told Timothy, if we endure suffering, then we shall reign with him. Well, suffering is troubling to me. I don't like suffering of any kind. I don't like when dinner is laid on the table. To me, that's like tribulation. We should probably, though, take a moment to identify who these saints actually are. Because we hear this word of the saints and we assume that Daniel was talking about Christians, the Church of Jesus. He did call them saints, and we are, after all, saints. We're the saints of Jesus. The Christian church is made up of saints. We are the people of the Messiah, the saints of the Messiah. But at this time, Daniel doesn't know about the church, nor does he know about these Messiah saints. In fact, nowhere in Daniel's prophecies does he specifically refer to the Christian church. Nowhere. He's not talking about the church. Now, Christians are clearly called saints in Scripture, but there are other types of saints that the Bible speaks about. For instance, there are devout Jews that are in Scripture. They're called saints. Throughout the Psalms, David, he writes in Psalm 30, sing praise to the Lord, you saints of his. In Psalm 31, O love the Lord, all you saints. In Psalm 34, O fear the Lord, you his saints. David's son Solomon said, he guards the paths of justice and preserves the way of his saints. Proverbs chapter 2 and verse 8. Now, these verses are all talking about worshipful or devout Jews, and they're also referring to these folks as saints, Bible saints, Jewish saints. Well, then there are those that we would call tribulation saints. Tribulation saints are believers who are going to be living in and through that great tribulation that Jesus talked about. Now, we believe, of course, that faithful believers will be raptured before the great tribulation. There's an incentive for you. The Bible tells us that a great number of people are going to put their faith in Jesus Christ during that terrible time of tribulation. In Revelation 7, once again, John said in verse 9, "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne, before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands." And John later on said in verse 13 of that very same chapter, Revelation 7 and verse 13, in the same context, one of the elders in heaven, in the vision of heaven, came and answered him, saying, "Who are these who are arrayed in white robes? Where did they come from?" And I said, "Sir, I do not know." So he said to me, "These are the ones who came out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." So these are the ones who are going to come to faith, well, you might say the hard way. They have to come to faith, and they have to persevere in that faith the hard way. And as they give their life to the Lord during the great tribulation, they're going to have to dodge the wrath of the Antichrist, who's going to specifically target them and any Jews that are living on the earth at that time, which there will be many. It will be a bloodbath for those who refuse to follow the Antichrist and to worship the false prophet, the beast. This is a terrible time on the earth. Revelation chapter 20, John said, "Then I also saw the souls of those who have been beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and for the word of God, and those who had not worshiped the beast or its image and had not received its mark on their foreheads or on their hands." So the Bible makes it very clear that there are going to be Gentiles who will be saved after the rapture and during this period of the great tribulation. And also, finally, there will be Jewish saints or believers. Paul said in Romans chapter 11, "And in this way all Israel will be saved, as it is written, 'The deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob,'" which Jacob is Israel. So God is going to remove the veil from their eyes, eyes of the Jews. And they're going to finally realize that Jesus was the Messiah after all. The way God put it through the prophet Zechariah in chapter 12, he said, "I'm going to pour out a spirit of grace on the family of David and on the people of Jerusalem. They will look on me whom they have pierced, and they're going to mourn for him as for an only son. They will grieve bitterly for him as for a firstborn son who has died." So all Israel is going to realize what they had done to Jesus, and they're going to say, "Oh, he is our Messiah. We could have had him all of this time, but we rejected him. He is the stone that the builders rejected. Oh, we could have had him." They're going to tear their clothes in mourning and in grief that they missed it for some 2,000 plus years. And all this to say that the church, genuine Christians, believers, are not at all who Daniel sees in that troubling vision of his in Daniel chapter 7. But what he sees is are these Jewish saints and tribulation saints. And what he saw caused great distress, and it troubled him. And it didn't comfort him enough what the angel said in the end, verse 26, the court shall be seated, they shall take away his, the Antichrist's dominion, to consume and destroy it forever, once and for all. In verse 27, then the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. So there's a happy ending. And we see that happy ending prophesied, predicted. But Daniel's people and the tribulation saints are going to have to get to that place the hard way. And it will all be done according to the scriptures, meaning all by God's design. He planned it all. Because one of the main reasons for the great tribulation is to take care of some unfinished business with Israel. Jeremiah wrote, "Alas, that day is so great, there is none like it. It is a time of Jacob's trouble, Jacob's distress." Jacob, remember, is Israel. But he said, Jacob shall be saved. This is from Jeremiah chapter 30. So you have an Old Testament and a New Testament verse declaring that Israel will be saved. And we're going to talk a lot more about that as we go further into Daniel's prophecies. But Jacob is Israel, and that's what we're talking about. There are other saints, is what I'm getting to. And the bottom line to all of this is that we have been given prophecy. Prophecy that warns us of what's coming, that gives us an opportunity to prepare for what's coming. The prophecies tell us that God is coming to judge the earth. And so it would therefore be a good idea that we heed what we read in prophecy. Heed what we read and not ignore it. The Lord is merciful enough. He's kind enough to give us prophecy along with plenty of time to make educated decisions. These things have been in this book for thousands of years. That's merciful. That's gracious and kind, compassionate. For God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. I've said this before, but anyone who ends up in hell really has to work pretty hard to get there. Billy Graham used to say, anyone who winds up in hell will have to step over the crucified body of Jesus to get there. Imagine that. As he lays his body across the entrance of hell and says, I don't want any of you to go. Can you imagine someone saying, yeah, thanks, but I'm just going to have to step over and enter that terrible place nonetheless. The bottom line, Jesus came to earth. He became a human, a babe in a manger. And then he grew up, became a man. He was crucified, died, buried, and then he rose from the dead. And he is alive today. And he's seated at the right hand of the Father with God. And he did all of that so that no one would have to go to hell. No one. He doesn't want any to perish. And the only thing that he asks in return is that we believe in him, that we accept his story of redemption, the story that I've just described to you. And if you believe in Jesus as the Savior, as your Savior, then you will be saved, and you will escape the judgment of hell, which is coming upon all mankind who have rejected Jesus Christ. Daniel closed this chapter. He says, "As for me, Daniel, my thoughts greatly troubled me, and my countenance changed. But I kept the matter in my heart." And I find it interesting, about 600 years later, after Daniel would write this, Gabriel would show up once again to prophesy, this time to a Jewish virgin. And he would tell her that she would bring forth a son, and that he would become the Savior of the world. Luke tells us then, Mary kept these things and pondered them in her heart. Similar. I imagine Mary was in the same boat. I don't understand this prophecy. How can these things be? Remember, she asked the angel, how can these things be? She was doing the same thing. Let's ask further. Let's ask further. I don't get it. Tell me more. I don't understand it. You see, there's another problem with prophecy. And that is that once we do understand it, once we know it, and we're responsible to act upon it, and then we'll be held accountable for what we know. Because hearing the gospel message demands a response. And the Lord said, "Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Today, if you hear his voice, believe." Problem solved. Problem of prophecy is solved. If you believe, and if you believe enough to respond, let's pray. Lord, here is a word of prophecy for us all. You've told us that trouble's coming. There will be trouble. You told us that there will come a ruler, a king, a leader, a governor who rules over a government. And he will force everybody to do his bidding. But he will not be the Christ. He will be the Antichrist. You said you come in your own name, and we reject you, but then someone will come in his name, and him we will receive. That to me is unacceptable, and it's unacceptable to you as well. You were not saying that as a good thing. I pray that you'll help us to believe in Jesus to the point to where we can't see ourselves living any other way. And we won't see ourselves living for anyone else except for you. Let our faith be so deep. Let our faith be so pure and so true, sincere, that we would walk with you in confidence and in peace. And in order to do that, of course, give us a passion and a love for the Word of God, the Bible. And as we study it and it's made available to us and revelation is made to where we actually understand it, that we'll believe it, and then we'll commit ourselves to it, devote ourselves to it, apply ourselves to it, and apply it to ourselves. Lord, help us in these days of trouble that are on this part of the earth, or this part of history. Help us to be your people, shining lights, shining lights. And we'll not put bushels over our light, but shine brightly and so that the world can see. If you're here today and you have not yet accepted the Savior, then this is an opportunity for you. You can turn your life over to him. You can believe. You can surrender. You can stop fighting against spiritual things and against the Holy Spirit. And you can give your life to the Lord right now by believing in him. There's nothing else you need to do. I'm not asking you to do anything else except in your mind and in your heart, you choose to believe that Jesus is the Savior. Believe it in your heart. Make that decision. Know it. Admit to him. Admit to him now in the privacy of your heart where no one else sees, no one else can hear your heart. Nobody does. No one else knows what's going on in your mind right now. But if you will admit right now that you are a sinner, admit it. I am a sinner. And then admit that you need a Savior, and that Savior is Jesus. And then in your heart, in your mind, say, Lord, save me. The three words, a three-word prayer. Lord, save me. That's a wonderful prayer. We thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. Now we come to you in faith and surrender. Our lives belong to you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.